Please click on continue on your screen to give your permission for recording. Yeah. So hi everyone, I'm Ruchi Kumar, an assistant professor at Center for Excellence in Teacher Education. And I'm the host of the School Synergy Workshop Series. We welcome you yet again to one more session of School Synergy Workshop Series. We have been having these sessions since last 2 years, and since last year in an online mode from August. We meet every week from 3 to 4 p.m. and we discuss ideas that are related to practice and that can be perhaps implemented in practice in the classrooms. We hope to have this platform provide ideas for teachers, a space for reflection for teaching learning, and also a space where new ideas can be collaborated and built together. So in this session, we are going to have Poonam Meth with us, who is a student also at Center for Excellence in Teacher Education and doing her PhD. And she is working on how stories can be used to teach science, and I'm sure that is a very interesting topic for all of you. She has also worked with us earlier in the design and evaluation of digital resources that we had made for teachers and for students, and I hope that she will be it will be a very fruitful session for all of us. I just want to make a few announcements for today's session. Today, at the end of the session, we'll be sharing a feedback form with you, like we do every time. And we are trying for the first time today to have automatic e-certificate generation through the feedback form itself. So when you submit the form, you will get the e-certificate in your mail, whatever mail you would have submitted in that form itself. And the form will also have directions for you to give your title and name clearly, as it will be reflected in the certificate itself. One more announcement regarding this is that we are trying to slightly change the mode of our engagement. So today in this session, Poonam is going to share ideas with you about how stories can be used to teach science. And next week, we are thinking of having an ideation session or an implementation reflection session with all the teachers based on this session itself. Like the ideas that you get from this session, you can perhaps develop a lesson plan, or you can develop a resource, you can develop a story that you can use with the students, and then you can share that in the next session, or you try out some story that Poonam has shared today with your own students in the classroom and share the experience of it. So we really look forward to the next session, because so far it has been mostly, the speakers have been speaking. They have tried to make these sessions interactive, but it would be truly synergistic if the teachers also come forward and share their experiences also. So we are trying to make an effort, and I hope you will support us in these efforts going forward. So without much further ado, I ask Poonam Meth to start the session itself. Poonam, thanks for being here. Over to you.
Thank you so much, Ruchi. Good afternoon, everyone. On behalf of the Center for Excellence in Teacher Education here at TIS, I welcome you all once again to our School Synergy series. Today's session, as you know, is using science stories to teach science. My name is Poonam Meth, and I'm thrilled to be talking about how stories can be pulled into the science classroom and also fulfill an emerging curricular need in science education, which I will be talking about in more detail shortly. I'm going to turn off my video because there seems to be a lag and I don't want that distraction. So, allow me to first outline what we will be covering today. I will begin with an overview of the importance of historical narratives as science stories, after which I will introduce this emerging need, the curriculum need that I talked about, which is nature of science. My first story that I will share with you in order to explain the nature of science is the discovery of circulation of blood, and then we will talk about how it maps to nature of science. My second story is the discovery of nuclear fission. So let's begin. Let me begin by saying that there is ample research today to show that depiction of science through stories can take children beyond the everyday recall and comprehension into a world that is exciting, into a world that ignites imagination to learn beyond scientific laws and theories. When I was doing my MA here in TIS, my faculty, Dr. Maxine Bernson, used to say, Poonam, these four words, once upon a time, have a far greater pedagogical impact than these four words today we will study. Narrative content is seen to be engaging, and we know that from our own experience as well, than expository content. But how do you actually make this happen? I mean, this is the core part of my research. So it is actually very difficult to have a greater proportion of narrative content in science, especially as one moves to higher grades. So today I will talk about how we can introduce stories in the science classroom through introducing histories of scientific discoveries and invention. These stories inherently reveal the historical trajectory of a particular discovery. In the words of Sundar Sarukai sir, this history helps students understand aspects of science much more than just understanding the content of science, that is laws, theories, and formulae. So history helps us understand that science and scientific methods have certain limitations. It also helps us understand that science is a result of the social context, the political context in which that discovery has happened. Another thing that we really don't pay attention to, and which Sarukai sir is saying, is that scientific stories of scientific discovery have numerous examples of creative thinking in science, and we miss out on that when we don't actually engage in these stories. How scientists use elegant speculation to arrive at theoretical constructs to answer some very fundamental questions about how the universe works. So this historical, philosophical, social, and creative aspect of science is collectively called nature of science, and has been an important addition to the science curriculum globally since the last two decades by educators as well as by the scientific community. In India too, there is a strong focus on this mentioned in the national curriculum framework. So let's delve a bit into what is nature of science, and before we actually move on to the stories. So what is nature of science? Coming up with a longish answer to this question, when we look at a particular scientific discovery or invention, we tend to look just at the that discovery, but that is not enough for us to understand the science behind it completely. So like I said earlier, science develops and grows within a certain social cultural context, within a certain political context, which if we don't consider, then we have not really understood that discovery completely. And that can lead to misconceptions, to misgivings about science as well as that discovery. So allow me to give you an example. Now, I think there is hardly anyone here who has been through middle school without hearing about the apple falling on Newton's head, leading him to discover gravity. Now, there are two problems with this particular kind of story. One, that it makes science seem like this sudden, once-in-a-lifetime, flash-in-a-pan kind of a moment where a breakthrough suddenly dawns on a scientist. And the lack of adequate historical, sociocultural, and political context only goes to confirm point number one, the first point. And it also makes science feel like this not within my reach kind of an effort. Growing up as I did, I had no exotic trees, or for that matter, nothing else exotic around me. And I was kind of left feeling that, you know, perhaps science is not for me, because I knew that I would never get so lucky as Newton did. So, but if now the same apple story can be made meaningful if we briefly consider the times Newton lived in, okay? Scientific revolution was at its peak. He was working with other scientists like Kepler to understand planetary motion. The environment at that time was charged with the spirit of inquiry and, with the spirit of invention and curiosity. It is within this buzzed environment and Newton's continuous dialogue with his colleagues, with his ongoing thought about these scientific problems, that he proposed the idea of gravity. The apple example was just his way of narrativizing a particular experience. And of course, whether it really happened that way or not is something that we don't want to kind of get into now. Now, knowing this context helps us better understand that the falling apple single isolated incident was not the only thing that resulted in a scientific breakthrough. What if we could also add a small sliver of detail, such as how Newton firmly believed in the power of observation and believed he could learn much more from observation than he could from textbook. This kind of knowledge, in addition to the apple narrative, provides a whole new level of realization and understanding that cannot be captured in Bloom's taxonomy, that goes beyond saying that gravity is a force that acts upon objects.
Poonam?
Yes.
Poonam, some people are complaining that the voice is not clear. There's a little bit of a problem with the mic, I think.
Okay.
Abhi, right now it seems okay. For others who it for the people whom the voice is not audible, it's the problem of internet. And for those who is the voice is little bit unclear, it's probably some mic problem. But it comes and goes. It's okay. Yes,
I think there is no any problem. Voice is clearly audible.
For you, it's clearly audible? Okay, great.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, thank you for confirming that. Poonam, please go ahead. Sorry for disturbing.
Not at all, Ruchi. What I will do is I'll hold the mic closer to my face and I'll try to speak slowly. And
is okay. Please go ahead. Yeah.
Thank you. Yeah. So, as I was saying, science is a human and a historical embedded truth-seeking enterprise and has many features such as cognitive, social, commercial, political, and ethical. And all of these need to be studied along with scientific content. Now, to help educators bring this large interwoven construct to classroom with ease, NOS or Nature of Science is often expressed into simply stated but deeply meaningful tenets like the ones you see on your screen here. So here is a quick listing of the key tenets. The first is that scientific knowledge is based on observations of the natural world, the scientist's own experience and her experiments. The second is that there is no single universal scientific method. There is no recipe. The third is that scientific knowledge is always changing. Science is tentative. The fourth is that when looking at data or information collected, scientists will use prior experiences, prior knowledge, personal beliefs to make meaning out of the observation. Scientists are also, they use creativity when inventing or providing explanations for their observation. The sixth is that society and culture dictate what is important to study and what is not. Certain scientific findings are not acceptable to society's belief and they will be rejected or ignored. And in the stories that I have lined up for you today, there's ample evidence of, we can see that when we get into these stories. And finally, the tenet is that scientists usually work together or they build on the work done by one another. It is rarely effort and an isolated effort. I just like to point out here that nature of science is quite a vast and detailed construct and not reducible actually to this list. But like I said, an initial acquaintance with this whole idea is possible because of these tenets, and especially when you want to take it to your classroom. But it definitely is a far more expansive idea than is possible to convey in a single session, but this is a good starting point. And now, you know, on lines of what I said earlier, I would like to explain these tenets through a story. So let's begin by, I will tell you a story shortly, which kind of serve as an illustration of some of these, not all of these, but some of these tenets. I'd also like to kind of let you all know that designing these stories or preparing these stories for these sessions, I've kind of assumed that there will be some domain knowledge, at least at a graduate level about science. So, pardon me if sometimes the content gets a little bit technical, right? So here is story number one. We are going to talk about the discovery of blood circulation by William Harvey, and it is set in the 17th century. And again, some of the stories I've selected, they map to the names and concepts that appear in middle school, that is 8th standard and 9th standard of state boards and 7th standard of CBSE. Yeah. Now, just to set the content-based context, I'm going to talk a little bit about blood circulation very briefly so that when I tell you the story, it kind of makes sense. Today we know that the heart is at the center of the circulatory system. It's the body's pump whose pumping motion is responsible for the blood traveling through the body. So it is the heart that sends the blood throughout the bodies, carrying oxygen to every cell. And it's divided into two pathways, the pulmonary pathway or the pulmonary circulation, where the heart sends blood to the lungs, gets oxygenated and takes it back, and the systemic circulation, where the oxygenated blood is sent through the aorta and which circulates in the entire body, and then it is brought back to the lungs by the vena cava. So this is broadly what you know, what is covered in the syllabus as of now and in 8th standard, and we will take this story on from here. Now, As I begin my story, just give me a moment. Before I begin my story, I'd like to dial back to 1500 years in 129 Common Era or AD. So one of the most influential scientists of that time was Galen, who was a Roman scientist, and he worked in Greece. He had extensively studied the human body and described several human systems and their function in great detail. So here is what he believed how the body, human body is structured. He said that the human body has three interconnected systems. The first is the brain and nerves. The second is heart and arteries. And the third is the liver and veins. The belief that existed that time and which was kind of conveyed by him is that the food that we eat is converted into blood in the liver. Once the liver converts the food in the blood, it is sent to different parts of the body where the blood is actually absorbed by the tissues. Okay, so like there are these pores in the tissues and the blood actually gets sucked into these tissues. Now, part of the blood also kind of goes to the heart. When it goes to the heart, it mixes with air and it mixes with something called as vital spirits. I noticed that someone had raised a hand. I will take questions once I finish the story so that there is no break in the flow as it is a little interconnected. So as I was saying, part of the blood goes to the heart where it mixes with the air and vital spirit. I'd like to at this point say that it was the age of vitalism. Okay, the times in which Galen made all these theories, there was this belief that living organisms function based on some non-physical elements rather than physiochemical or physiomechanical forces. From after the blood gets these vital spirits, it would go to the brain, and from the brain it would just kind of diffuse. It would just, poof, go away. We must again note Galen's context, why he's making these theoretical claims. Galen had no access to human cadavers, so because the religious and political authorities that time had banned the use, the dissection of human body, right? So he had studied other animal species to make these claims. Now, I'd like to draw your attention to a Galen's depiction of the circulation. You see how there are these, it doesn't kind of really touch. This is where it just went to the spirits. It was, it didn't really go anywhere. Did connect, that system really did not connect anywhere. You can see the same here as well. And this was pretty much his idea of what was called as the open circulation system. There was another thing that was very prevalent in Galen's time, and it continued to hold its reign for a number of centuries. That if we ate too much food, the liver would produce all of that into blood. Now, when there is too much blood in the body, there would be an imbalance in the liquid in the body, and that would lead to diseases. So how do you get rid of that extra blood? And that led to the practice of bloodletting, which is nothing but, depending on the disease that you have, you would place cuts on the human body and allow the blood to flow. When the blood would flow, the volume of blood would decrease and the body, it would come back into balance and your disease would be cured. This practice continued, and in fact, if you look at it, it still remains in some parts in the world even today. So this was the practice of bloodletting, which was very, very prevalent at that time. Now, as time went by, and as give me a minute, I'm not able to see my own screen. Just give me a minute.
Poonam, you are sharing the screen. Probably the participant had pinned somebody's profile there, and that's why I'm not able to see. You have to unpin that. We can see your screen. Please go ahead.
Okay, I'll go ahead. I can not see part of my slides, but that's all right. As long as you are able to see it, then I'm fine with that. Okay, so we come to around the 16th century now, and we are approaching the age of scientific revolution. There are far more experiments happening. Dissection on human cadavers is slowly being allowed, and many scientists come forward and oppose some of the things that Galen said, but the tradition, it was so deeply held that it was extremely hard to get. So these Michael Servetus, Vesalius, they all went against Galen's theories and proposed new ideas, but they could not fight against a Galenic tradition. What I'm going to do is I'm going to show you a small snapshot of what it looked like. So if you see, this is in 400 to 250 BC. There are only so many scientists, and all of them are working in one country. And now, during the scientific revolution, I just want to show you, give you a glimpse. We are not going into detail, but you can see the number of scientists who have started working in this area, even before William Harvey, have contributed so much more and have, you know, shifted from Galenic theories. And this is something that I just thought I will give you a glimpse of. Now, this is where, it is in this context that we have to view William Harvey's work and understand that no one scientist is actually responsible for a single discovery. So William Harvey was an Englishman. He had two doctoral degrees, one from Padua, which was the seat of all learning in those days, and one from the University of Cambridge. And he experimented over 40 animal species. He observed their live heart beating. He conducted a great number of experiments, such as phlebotomies, which is drawing blood from the veins. He captured reams of data on blood vessel dilations and used very rigorous methods. And it is said, even today, it is clearly documented that the standards that William Harvey set in experimentation are followed even today. They are not just followed in biology and medical sciences, but also in other fields of science. And this, we feel, is an important thing for us to convey to students and compare it to the flash in the pan kind of eureka moment or apple on head kind of a thing, and the kind of impression that gives versus the kind of image that this builds about science. And having pored over these results that he collected over the years, he published his book called De Motu Cordis, and which was a gigantic milestone. It was a small 70-page book. He also did something, he also used mathematics to a great extent. So he used maths to prove that blood was not being consumed by the tissues as Galen had said it was. And the quantity of blood more or less remained the same. And he did that by observing or by calculating the total volume of blood that moves through the body in an hour, and showed that it was too high for the body to replenish. And therefore, the amount of blood in the body, the human body, is the same, and it must be in perpetual motion. So he, this is a very simplified summarization of his work. He said, blood does not ebb and flow, it circulates in the body in one direction, and it is the heart and not the liver which is the engine which manages the circulation of blood. Now, the pumping motion of the heart is really a breakthrough discovery. It's not that others had not observed it, but presenting this with data, the way he presented this and the arguments and the supporting experimentation was a giant step, which really was one more nail in the, to kind of put away the idea of vitalism and move to a more physio-mechanistic era. This, how does this story connect to nature of science? I think if it is evident already, let's just look at some of the tenets of NOS and see how they are being reflected here. One is that I've already spoken about the importance of observation and experimentation of over a number of animal species. Yes, unlike Galen, William Harvey also did have access to human cadavers. So he could actually look into a human body. But still then, to imagine this, to cut open a body and not know which way the blood flows, it's not so easy. And just using indirect methods and indirect experimentation, he actually was able to give us this discovery, which is valid even today. Now, let me talk a little bit about the socio-political context, which did not come in the story. William Harvey was extremely, he did 2 degrees. He was very clear. The reason he studied at Padua and then added his Cambridge degree is because he always wanted to be a royal physician. It was after working for 16 years that he first, at the age of 40, he finally became a physician at the with the royal family, and he was extremely trusted and very loyal, and he continued to be the royal physician for several years. One of the reasons, many historians have written about this, one of the reasons that William Harvey's work was able to withstand the firmness of Galenic tradition is because of his closeness to the royal family. He had a lot of patronage and support from there. I also want to point out, in his journal he writes, in his book he writes about how he abstracted this entire circulation and he started to think about it as a circle. Okay, and that really gave that term, circulation of blood. This is one of the things that Sundar Sarukai sir talks about, which is the elegant representation of the problem itself, which helps you answer some of the most complex and fundamental questions in the universe. So with this, there was a paradigm shift in thinking that it is the heart and not the liver, which is the center of the circulation, and it is a closed circulation and not open circulation. And I think the collaboration and building on the work of other scientists is evident. I showed you that map, and so much work had already happened in the 16th century, which he was able to build on. The crux of nature of science is this, to see how science progresses, to understand the importance of observation and experimentation, which kind of becomes evident through this story. I'd like to pause for a minute here and see if there is something on the chat that I can respond to, if there are any questions, or if someone would like to unmute themselves and say something at this point. Ruchi, are there any questions in the chat that I could address?
I don't think so. Just let me check.
No, I'm looking at it right
so,
now.
No, it is all about the whether the screen is visible or not.
Okay.
Yeah. But if there are any questions, please feel free to unmute or post on the chat itself. I remember one person had raised the hand, whether it was... Garima Bansal asks, I wonder how can teachers access these stories?
Okay. Thank you for that question. I will address that towards the end of the presentation.
Any other questions? Anything you want to ask, you can also unmute and ask if you don't want to type. I think let's go ahead then.
Okay. Thank you, Ruchi. So in addition to what I have just said, is there anything that, so I have another question for you. If there's anything that strikes you as important for students to learn in this story, if anybody has any thoughts on this, what else do you think is important for students to learn through a story like this?
Knowing these stories helps students to place science in context.
Yes.
So it helps them to understand that how science is progressing gradually, and it is not a one-shot process that a discovery has happened.
Yes, absolutely. Yes, thank you for that response. So, please keep asking your questions in the chat. I'm going to now move on to my next story about the nuclear, about the discovery of nuclear fission. Although it is talked about, nuclear fission is, and its discovery is talked about in the textbook, we really don't get to hear her name. So anybody wants to take a guess who she is? Anybody? Okay. Lisa Meitner, a nuclear physicist who worked through two world wars, and this story is set in early 20th century Germany. She is credited with the discovery of nuclear fission, and I really hope you enjoyed the story because it's my favorite. Lisa Meitner studied in the beginning of the 20th century, and she was the second woman in Germany to receive a PhD in physics. So let's just, like I said, let's look at the scientific context of her times. Now, radioactivity was an exciting field at that time. There were so many, the scientific arena was buzzed with it. It was very chaotic. I'm not getting into the details of what and how, but an extremely potent field where there was a lot of opportunity for discovery. Now, it is just at that time that she received this PhD, and she teamed up with another scientist who was a chemist. She teamed up for interdisciplinary collaboration with Dr. Otto Hahn. Now, Otto Hahn was very focused on discovering new elements, but Meitner was focused on interested in understanding nuclear processes. Let's also understand the socio-cultural context at that time. This was no easy time for women to work in the science field, especially in the area of, in the domain of nuclear physics. In Berlin, she was not allowed to enter labs at her institute. While her collaborator had access to a lab, she had to work out of a small woodworking workshop next to it. And it was very gradually that this changed, and it was years before she was actually allowed access to a real lab. Now, Meitner and Otto Hahn continued to work through the First World War and discovered an element called protactinium. Now, towards the end of the First World War, new models of atoms were proposed, and scientists started to have a better understanding of the nucleus of an atom. So in they kind of kept working on and off. It wasn't very easy, but there was this significantly important experiment conducted at that time by Enrico Fermi. What he did was that, as you would be aware, as several other scientists had performed similar experiments, such as Rutherford, etc., who bombarded the gold foil. But Enrico Fermi bombarded the nucleus of the uranium atom with neutrons to see what would happen. Now, he found that new radioactive substances were created when he did that, and he proposed what is now called as transuranic elements, and it opened a whole new chapter in nuclear physics, but we are not going there. Now, Meitner found these experiments extremely interesting. So she told Otto Hahn that let's perform this experiment and you look at what are these new transuranic elements, whereas, well, I can study the nuclear processes that are taking place around it. By 1935, so in another 2-3 years, another scientist joined them by the name of Fritz Strassmann, and they formed, the three of them formed what was called as the Berlin group. So they continuously kept performing these experiments, and what they saw was that the nucleus of uranium would absorb the neutron and decay into a heavier element. But instead of behaving like a heavier element, it showed properties, chemical properties, similar to elements that are much lighter than uranium. In one such experiment, they found that the elements were showing properties similar to barium, and even a chemical analysis proved that. So we are still in 1935, 1936. I want to take a short break here from the science to switch to what was happening politically in Berlin at that time. We were looking at the rising of fascism in those regions, and it was getting more and more hard for Jews, for women to continue staying there and working within this context of fascist propaganda. And Meitner had to leave Germany. She moved to Stockholm and continued working from there with the Berlin group. Now, Hahn also was finding it really hard to believe that, I'm coming back to science now, that uranium was just kind of burst into barium, and they just could not find an explanation for why this was happening. They discussed this problem with many other scientists at that time, including Niels Bohr. Now, we are in 38, and by this time, Meitner's nephew, Otto Frisch, has joined Meitner in this whole endeavor. So now there are four of them working on it, and it is the December of 1938 where Otto Frisch goes to Sweden to meet Meitner, and they're sitting, they're walking through the snow, and they're having these intense discussions about, you know, why or how could uranium decay into barium. Now, I'm not talking about a eureka moment over here. I'm not referring to a eureka moment over here, but it is precisely during those days that Meitner visualized the nucleus as a drop of water. And she said, if something is happening to this drop of water, which is making it lighter, so it probably splits into two, like it's pinched from the middle and it splits into two, and there is enough energy there for it to be driven or for it to be repelled against each other. Now, if that is true, where is this energy coming from, right? So the energy for electrical repulsion. This is where Meitner uses Einstein's famous formula, which is is equal to mc squared. That is, when mass disappears, energy is created. I must confess, I don't fully understand this myself. My domain expertise does not go to that extent. But yeah, So she works out that the split nuclei would indeed be lighter than the original uranium nucleus. And this is the way they, Meitner and Otto Frisch, arrived at the first theoretical explanation of nuclear fission. And this phenomenon was named fission after how it is described in biology, when the splitting of the nucleus of the of an animal cell. So that same term is borrowed and we name it as nuclear fission. Now, they went on to separate. So Hahn and Meitner went on to separate, publish separate papers. Meitner was a physicist, Hahn was a chemist, on nuclear fission. And so it was similar to Harvey's discovery, which was a paradigm shift. They were able to, it was path-breaking in the sense that it came 40 years after 40 years of investigation into the nature of and properties of radioactive and radioactivity and radioactive substances. And it challenged many of the assumptions that were held as true in physics and chemistry, very much similar to how Harvey challenged what was held for 1500 years. Now, this conclusion that such an unusual reaction can occur signaled the end of a very, very exciting or a roller coaster ride in science and led to further investigations. And this particular experiment was then repeated by hundreds of labs across Europe and the US, and they confirmed Meitner's findings. Hahn went on to win a Nobel Prize in chemistry in 1944. Meitner, he did not mention Meitner's name at all. Meitner was also nominated, but denied the Nobel Prize. And you might find it interesting to know that she was nominated for a Nobel Prize in chemistry 18 times between 1924 to 1948. And she was nominated for a Nobel in physics 29 times, so a total of 47 times where she was nominated. And each time she was denied. I would like to introduce to you at this point a concept in sociology and in now extending to all fields called the Matthew effect. It is based on the Gospel of Matthew from the Bible, which says that the rich get richer and the poor get poorer. This concept is applied in many other fields, but in science, especially what it indicates as those who have recognition get more recognition, and those who don't get any recognition just don't, you know, go further into oblivion. Since we are talking about Meitner so much, I also want to take you back, if you remember, I talked about Enrico Fermi's experiment in 1932. His results were something that he was not able to explain, just like Otto Hahn and Meitner. There was another nuclear physicist at that time, Ida Noddack. She actually went against Enrico Fermi's discovery. But like Meitner, she also did not have an explanation. And it is written in history today that she was mocked and laughed off the entire scientific field. She was all her funding, all her resources to further do any experiments were taken away. And she also could not get a job because we were in the shadow of the 1929 Wall Street crash, and where it was, women were encouraged to stay at home, whereas jobs were to be saved for men. She, of course, was joined someone as an unpaid collaborator and continued working. But as it was to me, Ida Noddack's name is pretty much into oblivion. Coming back to the Mathieu effect, ironically named after the male name. This term was coined by Robert Merton in 1957, I think. But later on in 1993, it was changed to what is called as the Matilda effect, named after Matilda Joslyn Sage, who had also, she was a suffragist and an abolitionist, and she had undergone similar experiences. So it is now called the Matilda effect in science, which means that women in science have it tough because it is considered to be a male-dominated world. Mapping this story to nature of science, this was again one of the groundbreaking stories which challenged existing models in nuclear physics and chemistry, and it sort of gives us an example of how scientific discovery is not a straightforward path. It does not hinge on a single eureka moment, but involves a number of missteps, U-turns, and learning from mistakes. It talks about how existing assumptions are continuously challenged. It is indicative of the tentative, and because they are challenged, it is indicative of the nature of science, its tentativeness. If you recall a few slides ago, I had talked about one of the things about nature of science is that how it is situated in the social cultural context, and scientists usually do not always have a complete say in what will be studied and what study will be published. This Meitner story is a clear example of how there was a lot of government and state sponsorship for studying of radioactive elements. We were living in intensely polarized times, and the nuclear race was on, and Meitner was one of the people invited to be on this research, and she had refused. So this is again, the story is dripping with nature of science tenets. So this ends my second story. I hope you enjoyed it. And it kind of gives you a sense of, how scientists work in politically dangerous times. And how, like I said earlier, the research problem, choosing the research problem is sometimes not purely a scientific decision. It is hugely influenced by socio-political factors. I would urge you to think about and just comment upon how do you think a story like this can help in the classroom? What kind of discussions can it foster and initiate? If anyone would like to kind of quickly comment on this, and we'll be very happy to hear someone.
Hi, can you hear me?
Yes, yes.
So, ma'am, so far, we got this thing that many women scientists, sorry, I'm using the word women here.
Yes.
Scientists are scientists, basically.
Absolutely. That's all
what
right.
What has to be, do with the gender. But as we can see that, despite being this thing that they have contributed very well, actually, and, on their contribution, their male counterparts took all the credit and got Nobel and what so not.
Yeah.
So I think the title is saying that the stories which we can use in the science, but I'm taking this as like how the women are considered a weaker gender and treated as a marginalized member who is simply contributing in the field of science, but they are like a worker who are building a magnificent building, but the name on that building will be that, you know, chief executive engineer, that he or she, he, basically he, capital he, built that, you know, magnificent building actually. So
yeah,
this is something like that, so, which is a very sorry state for the science actually.
Absolutely. And what you absolutely said it correctly. What we are trying to say is this, that a holistic model of science education should include these aspects as well, and not just focus on the content of science, which is, you know, the theories and the formulae. And without this social and political context, the understanding of science somewhere may not be fully complete. You are absolutely right about the marginalization of even today when we look at stories, and in fact I wanted to talk about you know, Indian scientists such as Dr. Janki Amal, Dr. Bibha Chaudhary. It's in the context of Meitner losing out on the Nobel Prize. You know, my guide, Dr. Padankar, she tells me scientists don't work for Nobel Prizes, but, you know, it is a question, and she's absolutely right. They do what they love doing. But just as an indication of how this works, we see that, I would like to quickly mention about Dr. Vibha Chaudhary, who did path-breaking work on cosmic showers. Her guide was Dr. Patrick Blackett, who was with the American Army. Today, there are, when I look at the literature on this, it, you know, almost every historian says that it is unclear the contribution of Vibha Chaudhary on Patrick Blackett's receiving the Nobel Prize. He received the Nobel Prize for chemistry in 1945 or 1946, because in 1947, Patrick Blackett was invited to India as a consultant for the Indian Army. Dr. Vibha Chaudhary was also a part of that that commission or that team. So there have been in this day and age, the work of women scientists is really out there, and there are a lot of people who are bringing it out there, and it's really the next, you know, this is where we step in and we take it from out there and take it into the classroom, is really the point and one of the functions of nature of science.
And just to add one point here, as you know, like, there is a library in NCRT, it's called Janki Amal Library Section, basically.
Yes.
But that, even that building, you know, does not have even a single, you know, dedicated section, or, you know, even a simple, like, you know, a marble carving which says, you know, that Janki Amal was one of the, you know, greatest scientists who lead India on several, you know, scientific endeavors.
Yes.
Something like that.
Absolutely.
Or, you know, step inside this library and you will, you know, meet her and her, you know, fellow companions,
which,
you know, contributed in the field of science. So, you know, when institutes like NCRT, if they are not, you know, working, even though, you know, NCRT has a specific dedicated gender sensitive, you know, block established, but even then they are not doing enough, so that, you know, anyone who is going to NCRT will, you know, look and read that that is written over there, and, you know, will try to look further that, okay, who Janki Amal was and what her contribution was actually in the field of science.
I know about the library, but I've never been there, so I would like to add, I contacted while I was working on this, my research. Janki Amal worked in the Imperial College of Agricultural Research when I contacted them, they're in Coimbatore. They also had absolutely no information. I thought maybe I could get some pictures or some books or something that were internal to that institution, which I could use in my stories. But really, they said that there's nothing here. So it's a systemic issue, and it's not it's a systemic issue at two levels, perhaps. You know, one is science in India as well as, you know, women scientists in India. So perhaps we are not very good with packaging information and doing that. I don't know. That is really not something that I am able to comment on. But thank you for your thoughts and for your participation. Thank you so much. Is there anybody else who would like to kind of add to this discussion? You can have the chat then.
Yeah. Hi, Poonam. Thank you so much for this wonderful, very wonderful session. I want to say something that these stories, they are very good. But what I have observed as a teacher interested in stories, that it is very difficult to find out these historical aspect of science development. And it requires a lot of reading and regular teachers who have been teaching or who are in the job. I do not find them competent. It is not that they are incompetent, but their training had been such that they may not be able to locate these stories by reading huge amount of text and learning how has science developed over the years, first. And my second issue is this, that there should be clear guidelines that how these stories can be used along with specific pedagogic and assessment tools so that a teacher can easily take it up in her classroom. So that kind of guidance, if you could provide, it would be of great interest to all of us. Thank you.
Thank you for bringing this to the table. This essentially is a part of my research, and you're absolutely right. It is difficult to glean, and in the flow of everyday work, it can be a little difficult to just take something off the internet and present it to children as a historical fact. So yes, it is definitely an area of problem. So these are the two stories I had planned. I would just like to go back to where we started this presentation to say that we started off by saying that, you know, more scientific, more narrative content is required in the science classroom. And one way of bringing that content is through stories of scientific discoveries. And also, bringing in an emerging curricular need, which is becoming very important to have, like I said, a more holistic science education, which is nature of science. So a very quick listing of why nature of science is important in the curriculum, because as the National Academies Press says, it supports informed citizenry and supports democratic discourse when you are aware of the socio-political context. It also helps learn science in a much better way. And in addition to providing scientific literacy, it also helps with scientific content itself. So these stories did not just focus on one aspect of science, which is the science context, or only on the social part. It kind of brought the two these aspects together to say that this is really how science is. And above all, it prevents the formation of stereotypes of scientists, which is, first is they are portrayed as, all of them are portrayed as being men, they're portrayed as being nerdy, and they're portrayed as being very eccentric, whimsical, devoid of creativity and imagination. These kind of portrayals of science in popular culture can also lead to misconceptions about how science works, and the idea of science being very difficult and male dominated. Like I like to say that we need to throw the bath water out of the Archimedes stuff now, because that, you know, that Eureka moment and the Eurekaization of all scientific discovery has done, it can be quite harmful. As we have seen in our stories, that for a scientific invention to take place, it takes a long time. It's a lot of effort, a lot of hard work, and it's not a flash in the pan kind of a thing. While that does happen at some point, but it is backed up by a lot of other effort. Nature of science also helps students appreciate science, helps them appreciate, they feel, when you say science is tentative, the students get a sense that, work is ongoing in science. Otherwise, they say that, okay, I've done everything now. So what else do I need to do? So everything is now invented, kind of a thing. So it also throws light on some of the strengths and limitation of science and the role of science in social decision making. I would just like to say, talk a little bit about how do we actually do this in the, how do we pull these stories in? And how, where do you search for this information? So let's say you wanted to get information about, Dr. Janki Amal, because Dr. Janki Amal's work corresponds very closely to a chapter in 8th standard, where I'm not able to recall the exact, but when you start looking for information, use the trusted sources such as National Geographic, the Smithsonian Institute, if you don't have access to some credible books. If you encounter an article which sensationalizes something, then that's where you become alert to say that this is not how it is. Let me make a case in point here. A lot of articles will tell you that William Harvey used hypothetical deductive methods. But so did Galen. So Galen wasn't a lesser of a scientist. He used the resources available to him that time. And he also used experimentation and observations of a certain type. Does not make Galen a poor scientist or a wrong, incorrect scientist. It does not cancel out his work. So articles that sensationalize this always have to be avoided. Okay? One way to which I have also found, and fact checking is so important in this kind of stories, is that you go to several sources. So if the Smithsonian says something about Janki Amal, you check it back. You don't feel satisfied and happy at that one find. You search other resources as well to make sure that the same thing is coming out. Now, I'll give you an example. If I look at, I just shared with you that Meitner was, nominated for a Nobel Prize in Physics 28 times between 1935 and 1965. Sorry, 37 and 65. So it doesn't add up, actually. It's 28 times, whereas there are only 27 years. So those kind of things you need to be alert with that, and then go deep, go one level deeper and say, what is happening? It's just that there were two nominations in a particular year, so it's 28 and not 27. So these are some of the things that I have used to put together these stories. I also would like to say that, and I've said it earlier, but I'm re-emphasizing that science and socio-cultural aspects both need to be balanced in it to bring about the nature of science aspect of science. And failures or experiments that did not work are as important as experiments that work, because that is how science is. It's never a first time get it right kind of a situation. Fortunately, we are at that stage where the textbook gives us the door is ajar. It's not fully open. I mean, it will be open the day, you know, we are able to have like you just mentioned, where we can have a more structured way, a pedagogical plan and vetted stories in consumable form when they also appear. But right now, textbooks are actually, this is a learning outcome which is mentioned in the Maharashtra State 8th standard science textbook, where it's clearly saying that students should be able to discuss and appreciate stories of scientific discoveries. And we have these little blurbs in our science textbook which provide as springboards for us to look at this in more detail and go beyond just the factual information that is provided here. And with that, I would like to summarize and sum up this session where I would like to say this in so many words, that stories of scientific discovery are a match with nature of science, both today fulfill a way through which we can use science stories to teach science and also satisfy the need for having nature of science. We do have support from our curricular documents. And above all, this engages and informs students to be more active participants in scientific thinking. It shows scientific thinking to be a deliberate effort rather than the flash in the pan kind of thinking. And that is how it should be in a democracy. And on that note, I would like to summarize and conclude my session today. And I hope you found this useful. I'm just going to look at the chat to see if there are any questions.
Thank you so much, Poonam. It was really, really interesting. And you should see the chats and the kind of discussions that have happened on the chat itself. Yeah. People have appreciated the kinds of stories that you have shared. And they are saying that, yes, the need for such stories is definitely there. I think there was one person who wanted you to go back to the map slide that you had because she had missed some point there. Some are requesting that they would really like to see your PhD work, read up your PhD work, and ask you to coming up with the compilation of these science stories for the larger good.
Yes,
good.
Yes. I will be doing them.
That. Yes, your work is exactly that. Yeah.
So this is, I'll just take you to page 1. I will try and increase the size here. So this is spanning 400 BC to 250 Common Era. Okay, before Common Era. Okay. I must mention that this is work in progress, etc. I have not talked about all of this. I just came straight to Galen. In 12th century Common Era, work on digestion circulation was done in outside of Europe as well, especially in Egypt and Arab countries. This was recognized even by Galen, and it was these studies informed Galen's work. Of course, there is work that was done even in India, but that goes into in this, before the Common Era, and it is not currently displayed here. And I'm now going to go to the next page. This is the next page, which is from 1400 AD to, and can't see parts of my screen, to 1700 AD. And you can see that that these years are very, there are a lot of people. In fact, I can't fit so many scientists. It would be a very, very big diagram. It was difficult to get so many people in. If you look at, and I'm just talking from the point of view of the what is there in the science textbook. If you look at different things such as digestion, such as the atomic discovery, you can find these maps. They touch upon different locations in the world, and it's a very interesting, this is an infographic actually, just to give a one-shot view of, it is not meant to be a replacement for this course, just a support, visual support for the discourse. Can I switch back now to the...
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you so much, Poonam. Any further questions? We have time for...
Yeah, we have time for questions.
One or two questions maybe? Poonam, how much time do you have?
No, I have time.
Okay, you have time. Right. So any questions, please ask. You can ask on the chat. You can unmute if you want. I'm also sharing the feedback form. When you fill and submit the feedback form, you will get the certificate in your mail. Please go ahead and ask her questions.
Hello, excuse me. Can you please show the slide number 19 once again, just for 2 minutes?
Yeah, sure.
Thank you.
So I should also say something that I had in mind, Poonam. It is really, really interesting to see these stories. And these are the stories of women scientists also, which have not been often known to public. And therefore, it has got really great value for our students in encouraging women and girls for doing science itself.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Vivek Shaman has raised his hand. Please unmute and speak. Slide 19, she said, Poonam.
Yeah,
I think the next one.
But that's just an image, actually. That's why I was... So
okay.
Hello.
Okay. Yeah, we can hear you. We can hear you.
I wanted to see this image once again. Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you.
Not a problem. Thank you. Yeah.
Okay.
Hello.
Yes, we can hear you, Vivek. Please go ahead.
Madam, I want to ask that for understanding the nature of science, these stories are beneficial. But is there any another way besides the story which can help to understand nature of science?
Of course there
Thank
is.
Thank you.
Yes, Vivek. Definitely. While I'm not an expert in all the methods, but there are other methods that have been documented, such as flashcards or games even, or talking to scientists, for example, which can also be used. So, I mean, excuse me for not knowing all of them, but yes, you're right that stories is just one of the ways in which we can use these, we can approach these ourselves.
Thank you. Any other questions?
Okay, Poonam, I would like to thank you for this session. I am a researcher in education and
Dr. Bansal, I've referred to your work in my PhD. It's such an honor to be talking to you on this forum. I'm really, really delighted to, your work is very inspiring for me. So thank you for being
here. Nothing like that. We all are researchers and part of the same community.
Yeah.
Only one thing that I would, I am striving for, but I couldn't, that there should be a compilation of these stories in a very, very easy and well illustrated manner.
Yes.
Which could go to an ordinary school teacher. She can read it and she can use it the way she wants it.
Yes.
So that, I think, see, as researchers, we always strive to publish more and more papers. Mm-hmm. But teachers, they are unable to read it and understand it and use it.
Absolutely.
So, I know that it is a time-intensive process. You may require funding. But keeping all those things into consideration, please, I request you that for the larger Indian masses and international masses, please come up with a small compilation of 8 to 10 stories. Even that would be good. And Vigyan Prasar has come up with a comic book in which they discuss in those bubble form that how classical mechanics, Newtonian mechanics and Einsteinian mechanics.
Yeah. So
that is something I think would be a useful resource to you.
Yeah.
And, yeah, thank you very, very much for this wonderful session.
No, Dr. Bansal, this will be the artifact that I will be producing at the end of my PhD. So it is very much my desire as well to bring out a teacher resource, which is exactly like you said, easy to read, illustrated, partly illustrated, and we're very much on the same line of thought.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you so much. Really, I'm thankful to you, Poonam, for being here and sharing such interesting stories. Just wanted to ask a question to all the teachers. Can you please raise hand who will be interested in joining the next week's session with us on the ideation and implementation reflection session on these science stories? Can I have a show of hands, please? Okay, great to see so many hands, and I hope that these number of hands will just keep on increasing. We will really wait for you next week to either share some story which you think would be useful to share in the classroom, or you share the experience of implementing such stories in the classroom. Okay. And so these are actual science stories and not science fiction. Yes, that's what I wanted to tell you about. Not fiction. These are actual science stories. That's why in the title we had written science stories. So I hope you would have all filled the feedback form and got your certificate also. Shalini, are you there? Shalini?
Yes, ma'am. Yeah. Yes.
Yeah, Shalini, would you like to thank Poonam and end the session then?
I myself as a student, it was a great opportunity to learn and to hear such real scientific story examples. And definitely I know that it will be also a very, we always as a student look for a learning which is more enjoying in nature. And definitely when we find such examples in classroom, it becomes very interesting, and definitely children as well as the teacher enjoy the classes. So thank you, Poonam ma'am, for providing this opportunity to each one of us, and thank you participants for your all kind of suggestion and examples. It was interesting to see the discussion which was happening in chat, and please keep updating your suggestion and feedback and all such kind of examples in Telegram groups also. Let's make this virtual learning as much as a great learning platform for each one of us. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, Ruchi. Yeah.
So we will release the this video on YouTube in 1 or 2 days, and we will also share it on our Telegram group. So just wait for a few more days. So right now, we just bid adieu from you, and we will meet again next week.
Ma'am, I just want to add one more thing.
So sure, Shalini. Go ahead.
Yeah, it's regarding the feedback form. So there we have one space regarding any question, or do you want to know anything about the particular session? All the participants, I request to please, whatever you find important, even regarding the future sessions, please feel free to give your suggestion and your feedback, because as much as reflective it will be more possible for us to provide a session which are more engaging in it. So, yes, thank you.
Yeah. So the name of our Telegram group is School Synergy Teachers Forum. And we have also shared the link in the chat. If you go up, scroll up, you'll find it. Chitra will also paste it again in the chat itself. We'll just hang on with you for a few more minutes so that you get all the links. But in terms of the session, let's end the session here and let's see you all next week at 3 p.m. to discuss
Looking forward to meeting all of you if possible.
Yeah.
And
yeah.